It's 4:30 a.m. in a park in Gateshead. Chris and Joe's footsteps are the first things to break the silence as the dawn approaches.
Can you hear that cockerel?
That man did a cockerel. Oh, loud.
That's not strictly the dawn chorus.
The third time I've heard the cockerel, doesn't
it?
Yeah, that's like a morning call, isn't it?
As things begin to stir, it's not long before they hear the more traditional members of the dawn chorus.
That's a blackbird. That's my favourite song.
Isn't it fantastic?
There's another one.
It's beautiful, yeah.
Another blackbird. They're all over. But
I like the blackbird, but I like them.
I do. So, Joe, we're now surrounded by birdsong.
Yes.
There's lots of birds in the dean. Mm-hmm. There's lots of birds all around us. If you look up and, I mean, you just see bare branches.
Yeah.
But up there, there's dozens of birds singing their hearts out. It's hard to pick out individuals, so that's why it's called a chorus.
It's a real chorus. But now you can see it's getting lighter, it's getting louder, more and more birds song.
You're right, this really is the most intense part of the dawn chorus. It's actually before dawn. In fact, there's a robin right over your head, just singing in the tree above. Very high pitched, warbling. And it's singing from a high point, so it's warning other robins not to come into this territory. That's a song for repeats its phrases. That's great, that's another new one. That is a chaffinch.
Yeah.
So it's just woken up that bird. Start to sing.
Yeah.
And you can imagine the energy that it takes to sing with that power.
Yeah. It's a completely different sound to me because if you get away from the hustle bustle of the loud world, and I just had no idea that it was down the road, it's just amazing.
So, Joe, it's daylight. We can see everything around us now. The dawn chorus has been and gone, and it's fantastic for me to share it with you, but how was it as an experience?
Well, first of all, thank you for introducing me to an experience that I've never had before. It has been absolutely fantastic. I didn't realise that there were so many different birds. Like you said, you've mentioned so many different birds this morning and how different they all sound. And I think I could actually identify the blackbird and the robin from the different songs that we have.
Yeah, it's a good place to start, so you know blackbird and robin now.
I might start getting up earlier in the morning now.
Just imagine hearing birdsong for the very first time. Most of us take it for granted because we're so familiar with it. Mind you, I can't imagine taking a dawn chorus for granted. It's always an incredible experience. And if you've never done it, then I suggest you get up early one morning this weekend and go and enjoy it. And if you've done it before, do it again and listen to it with fresh ears. It's not the only thing we're encouraging you to do this weekend. We're also doing the Garden Bio Blitz. Now, this is something that we did on Springwatch last year, and it's basically a blitz of your garden to see how many different species you can find, and it's a great thing to do with the kids. All the details of that are on our website, bbc.co.uk/springwatch. Oh, Chris, you've bought a beautiful bird.
I have indeed. And we'd like you to look out for these this weekend and going forward too. It's a barn owl, of course, and if you are lucky enough to have them anywhere near you, they're quite apparent at this time of year because often they'll be hunting in daylight if they've got young. And the reason we want you to look for them is that this is a species in crisis, I'm afraid. From about 1900 through to 1980, they declined by about 90%. We then managed to stabilise their population, and the reasons they went down were loss of habitat, loss of nesting places, loss of food. Also, these days, I'm afraid that many of the young birds at the end of the season are hit by cars. And there's some thought that rodenticides are building up in their bodies as well. So, the Barn Owl Trust have launched the first full barn owl survey for 10 years. And you can find their website via ours, bbc.co.uk/springwatch. And you can there put in all of your sightings of barn owls. So if you find a nest, you can note it, but of course be careful not to disturb it. They're legally protected. If you see a bird, that's good. Or if you even find a dead one or a roosting bird, we'd like to hear about it so we can remap their distribution and get a handle on their conservation.
It's nice to see them up close, because normally we get barn owls, don't we, on Springwatch?
We do.
Regularly had them,
we
and this
do.
Year we haven't.
Yeah, curiously,
so very nice to see it up close. Oh, yeah. You're so soft, aren't you?
Stunning thing. Beautiful heart-shaped face, which I think endears them to people because they have a slightly human appearance with their beaky nose there. But of course, that's the equivalent of these gristly bits of our ears, because they rely on their hearing so much for hunting. And this proved a real problem last year when we had that very wet spring. They can't hear properly to hunt. They don't like flying in the rain. And when people went out to look at their numbers last year, they found that there'd been a 71% reduction in nest occupancy. So last year was a very poor breeding season for barn owls. And what we're hoping is that those that got through the spring and the previously harsh winter will have a better breeding opportunity this year. So keep your eyes open for these barn owls.
Now, we're encouraging you to do lots of things over the next 3 days, so I guess you'll want to know what the weather's going to be like, not just for you, but for the wildlife as well. So let's go live to the BBC Weather Centre, where I'm sure Nick Miller can enlighten us.
Thanks, Michaela. I've got a forecast, but it was a challenge today because the choice was prepare the forecast, watch the blue tit webcam online. Forecast blue tit. Well, thankfully I managed a bit of both, and actually it's looking okay for the next few days. Now, remember at the start of the week I had low pressure behind me and the talk was of rain, and we had a soaking day of course on Tuesday at Minsmere, but now it's high pressure building in for tomorrow and Saturday, an isolated shower but most places dry, mixture of cloud and sunshine. On Sunday, weather fronts do come into Northern Ireland and Scotland. Yolo might see a bit of that rain in Western Scotland. But there's uncertainty about how much of England and Wales will see that rain during the day. So keep checking the forecast. But basically, it's good news if you want to get out and discover the wildlife near you. Listen to the dawn chorus. For the UK as a whole, a lovely start to the weekend. Some of us, though, getting some rain by the time we get to Sunday. And what does that mean for you at Minsmere? Well, it's mainly dry. The bitterns and the avocets don't need to worry about those rising water levels. Could be a bit of rain on Sunday night. There may be an isolated shower. But generally, it's great weather for the birds gathering the insects to feed the chicks. And who knows? Increasing sunshine tomorrow, the sight of some blue sky may finally get those blue tits to fly the nest. I'll be watching.
So it's been grey and rainy and a little bit miserable all week. When does it brighten up? When we're off air on Friday.
Tomorrow?
Yeah, tomorrow.
We're coming to the end of the programme, but we've got one more treat. We've got another live nest. It's a reed warbler. Let us go straight to it now. There it is. Now, this nest, it's got four eggs in it. It's down in the scrape. And here's the incredible thing. This little bird, we've been talking about the cuckoo, this little bird will also have travelled from Africa to be with us tonight. It will have travelled thousands of miles to make that tiny little nest in the reed bed. Isn't that astonishing?
Looks quite sleepy, doesn't it?
Oh, I've had enough of the show.
But do you know what's really interesting? Is that this is a host of cuckoos. A cuckoo, if it's lucky, will lay an egg in a nest, in a reed warbler nest. But look at what we've observed. They're very, very attentive parents, and they're hardly ever off the nest. As soon as one goes, literally 2 seconds later, the other one comes in. And we've been watching this, 11 changes in 3 hours, and exactly the same. One goes off, one, two. 2 seconds later, the other adult pops back. And again. Off it goes, one, two, 3 seconds later. So, Chris, how on earth does a cuckoo get in there to lay an egg?
It's a very good question, but the cuckoos have thought about that. On average, it takes about 6 seconds for that nest changeover, but it takes 10 seconds for a cuckoo to lay an egg in the nest. It removes one of the reed warblers and then it lays an egg in there for 10 seconds. So quite clearly, it hasn't got time. But take a look at this cuckoo, because over a period of time, they've evolved to look a bit like a sparrowhawk. So when they fly in, they scare the birds off. Now, you might think they could just look like a cuckoo and that would scare the birds off, but if the bird's not sure whether it's a cuckoo or whether it's a sparrowhawk, it will keep it away for a little bit longer, and this will give it just enough time for the cuckoo to get in there and lay its egg. And this is an example of what we call Batesian mimicry. Absolutely fabulous work from the cuckoo, I say.
I think we should take one quick look at our teasing tits. Have they left the nest? There
oh,
they are,
still
live.
There.
Oh, it would have been great to get them fledging live, wouldn't it? Are they all still there?
Yes, I think so.
And I've been keeping an eye on our live cameras throughout the last hour, willing them to fly out of that nest hole. But
I don't think they're going to go this evening. It's
not this evening? Too dark now?
No, it's too dark.
Too dark.
They'll go in the morning, and particularly if we get a nice, clear, warm, sunny morning, unlike any of those we've had so far this week.
Well, of course, we will update you on Monday, and we will show you them fledging if you haven't already watched it on the red button and online. But we're not just catching up with what we're doing here at Minsmere. Our camera teams have been filming all over the country.
Now, our mission is to explore the wildlife here, and we're going to try and up the ante, because the night creatures have proved elusive. So we're going to throw some new technology at it. Same technology we had on Winter Watch, night cameras. So we'll try and explore what's going on. We've just had a hot tip that there's a tawny owl available as well, so we're going to try and see that making night moves.
That's not all. We've also had tantalising glimpses of this creature. What is it? Well, it's a predator. It's a stoat. We'll be on the trail this weekend and hopefully be able to bring you some fabulous pictures on Monday.
It's a bit more than tantalising. That was oblique. There'll also be more of these, the Ralph C. Nesbitts of the bird world. A couple of bittern chicks. They're on the grow and they'll be moving off into the reeds. So keep your eye on those over the weekend and we'll hopefully see some more of them at the beginning of next week.
Now, you can watch us on Red Button and Unsprung, and don't go away because it's going to be Unsprung immediately after this, and we'll look forward to seeing you at 8 o'clock on Monday here, but for now, it's goodbye for us.
Bye-bye.